Hello students, the topic that we are going to cover today is the law commissions and codifications of laws in India. Now, this is the second part that we are dealing. There is another one video that I've already sent to you. The part one has been sent to you about the law commissions and codification of laws in India. I've divided this topic into two parts, part one and part two. Part one caters about the first and the second law commission, whereas part two caters about the third and the fourth law commission. So we are starting with this topic. I told you why there was a need for a law commissions and codification of law. Majorly, it was there because there was no uniform legal system that was administered in the whole British India. That means there was no one single law that was applicable throughout the length and breadth of the country. Different states, different presidencies, different provinces had their own laws, had their own legal system. And because of that, there was, you know, difference in punishments that were given. For example, I've told you, a person who have committed a murder in, for example, Calcutta was given death penalty, whereas the same person who has committed a murder, maybe in somewhere else, maybe in Bombay or somewhere else, he would be given a life imprisonment. So basically, you can see there has been a difference in the punishment that needs to be assigned. Somewhere harsh punishment is given, somewhere a little harsh, or you can say a lenient punishment is given to the people who commits a crime. And therefore, what was required? Therefore, it was required to have law commissions in India, which will codify a uniform system of laws for India. And just to give you a brief, what happened in 1833, a charter came, and that charter of which was introduced by the British government made very important two changes. First of all, that charter introduced that from now onwards, law commissions will be appointed to codify the laws in India. And secondly, a legal member, also known as a law member, will be included in the Governor General Executive Council. He will be a legal expert and obviously guiding the people about the legal, legal background or legal thing, giving advice about the legal matters. And Lord Macaulay was the first law expert that was included to the Governor General Executive Council. So this was just the introduction that I was introducing it to you people. I have already introduced this in my part one also, just a brief introduction about which charter led to the settling up of law commissions in India that codified the laws for India. So now when the law commissions will be there, I told you in the, just revising it for you, in by the first law commission, the IPC draft was made. The first law commission came under Lord Macaulay, and the IPC, which you people know, Indian Penal Code draft was made, it was presented, but it took a little long years. That means it was only passed in 1860. So 1860, the IPC has been framed. The second law commission, the second law commission also deliberated upon the Lex Loci report. Lex Loci report, I have told you, basically what law should be applicable to the non-Hindus and non-Muslims. And what has been said by the Lex Loci report, it said that the first law commission said that for the non-Hindus and non-Muslims, the substantive law of England should be applicable. And whatever the law that has been followed, the substantive law that has been followed in England should be applicable to the non-Hindus and non-Muslims. And then we come to the second law commission, and the second law commission, basically other acts were made. Majorly, it presented four reports. The first report talked about judicial reforms. The second reports talked about that whatever recommendations has been made regarding the Lex Loci report should be accepted. And yes, Lex Loci, that means what should be the law of the land for the non-Hindus and non-Muslims. It was agreed that the substantive law of England should be applicable as the law of the land. And by the third and the fourth report, majorly focuses on the amalgamation of the Company's Court and the King's Court, and there'll be a High Court that will be established. And you people know in 1861, even the High Courts were established. So this was the complete, the first and the second law commission that I have given to you. Now we'll be doing what the third and the fourth law commission has with them. Now I'll start with the third law commission. On 2nd December 1861, third law commission was appointed under the chairmanship of Lord Romilly. This phase became famous as the golden age of codification. Now, from on 2nd December 1861, the third law commission was appointed, and the chairman of this third law commission was Lord Romilly. And after this, once the third law commission came into being, once it started functioning, this phase is also known as the golden age of codification. Why? Because a large number of laws were codified during this phase. So third phase is also known as the third law commission phase, is also known as the golden age of codification. Why? Because numerous codes, numerous laws were made during this phase. Therefore, I'll tell you what are the laws that are made. Now, task fixed for the third law commission. So basically, what was the task that was fixed for the third law commission? Firstly, the third law commission was appointed with the purpose to prepare for India a body of substantive law, and in preparing the same law of England should be used as a basis. So first of all, the task that was given to the third law commission was that it was appointed with a purpose. The aim of appointment of the third law commission was to prepare for India a body of substantive law. That means a substantive law, like it is there in England, some kind of law or same kind of law should be applicable to India also, which will be there throughout the length and breadth of the country. And therefore, the third law commission was majorly appointed to prepare the substantive law. To prepare the substantive law for India, but obviously the people do not know, or people do not have so much of knowledge about how it should be, how that substantive law of India should be, and what should be the basis, and how it should be constructed, how it should be drafted. Then that third law commission was told that in preparing the substantive law for India, you can use the law of England as the basis. That means you can obviously refer to the law of the England, and then you can prepare the substantive law of India. But which one enacted should itself be the law of India on the subject it embraced. So once it is enacted, it will be the law of India. Secondly, the third law commission was also charged with the duty of considering and reporting on such matters relating to the reforms of laws of India as might be referred to them by the Secretary of State. Second duty of the law commission was also to consider and report on matters where reforms in the laws are required. Now, for example, there are certain laws which have become outdated, there is a need to reform those laws. Therefore, it was said that the duty is also to consider and report on the matters in India whether reforms are required in the laws which are there existing. And this can be referred to the Secretary of the State, or this can be referred by the Secretary of State. So basically, if they consider that yes, there are certain laws in India which needs reforms, then obviously they can refer these matter to the Secretary of the State. That is known as SOS. So you people know, after 1857, a Secretary of State office was created in that used to sit in England. I told you Viceroy used to sit in India, but there was a Secretary of State office that will consider the British possessions. So that was created, the Secretary of State was created, and a 15-member Indian Council was also appointed. So basically, whenever Third Law Commission thinks that the reforms are required on these laws, they can refer this matter to the Secretary of the State. So what is there? The Third Law Commission came under the chairmanship of Lord Romilly, and it came in 1861. This time is also known as the golden age of codification, because a lot of laws were codified during this time. And the task that was given to the Third Law Commission was firstly to prepare a substantive law for India, and the substantive law of England can be used as a basis. Second, the Third Law Commission was also charged with a duty to consider and report on matters in India whether laws require reforms, and such if it requires reform, then such matters can be reported to the Secretary of State. So basically, this was the task that was designed for the Third Law Commission. Now we come to the reports that were submitted by the Third Law Commission. If you can see, there's seven codes or seven reports that were submitted by the Third Law Commission. Excuse me. Now, the first report was about the Indian Succession Bill. In Indian Succession Bill, that means who will be the heir, who will be the next person who will be succeeding the property. The Succession Bill was passed. Year or date of it was 1863. When it became an act, in 1865 it became an act. So both the dates are mentioned, when it was framed, when it was drafted, kab bani thi, and when it was passed as an act. So the first report was of Indian Succession Bill. It was drafted in 1863. It was passed in 1865. The Contract Bill, it was prepared in 1866, but it was passed in 1872. You must be dealing with contract law, so this is the same. Negotiable Instruments Bill, it was drafted in 1867 and it was passed as an act in 1881. no draft or any code was submitted in 1867, but the commission submitted its observation in reply to certain remarks and objections of the government of India against the inclusion of section dealing with the law of specific performance in the draft of law of contract contained in its second report. So basically in the second report, majorly whatever the second report is about the contract bill, and there was a section in the contract bill known as the inclusion of the law of specific performance. So within the contract bill, there was a section that was included known as the law of specific performance. So regarding this, the Third Law Commission recommended something to the government, and it marked basically the objection to the government of India against the inclusion of section dealing with the law of specific performance. So why this law of specific performance was added, this was questioned by the Third Law Commission. In the fifth report, the evidence bill was drafted in 1868 and it became an act in 1872. Transfer of property bill, it came as a sixth report. It was drafted in 1870 and it was passed in 1882. And the last is the revised draft of criminal procedure. I told you the criminal procedure work and the civil procedure code work started during the Macaulay time only, during the First Law Commission only. But a revised draft is being prepared by the Third Law Commission also, and it was in the year 1870 that it was drafted. I'm sorry, this will be 1881, I guess. Just wait for a minute. Yeah, it is 1873. So it came into force in 1874. So this will be this is quite a long. So I'll confirm you the date about this, the date about A, you can write 1881 at that time. Obviously, the criminal procedure code has gone into a lot of revisions and drafting, and therefore, the first one, it was drafted in 1870, but it took a lot of time for it to get actually passed. So therefore, I've written revised. So these seven reports were submitted by the Third Law Commission: the Indian Succession Bill, the Contract Bill, the Negotiable Instruments. It debated and it objected about why the section regarding the law of specific performance is included in the Contract Bill, the Evidence Bill, Transfer of Property Bill, revised draft of criminal procedure. Everything was like stated in the or drafted by the Third Law Commission. That reports were submitted. Now we come to the achievements of the Third Law Commission. If you understand what has been the achievements of the Third Law Commission, then it submitted draft of six major pieces of legislation within a short span of 9 years. If you can see that within 9 years, if you can see over here, 1861 it was appointed, and 1870 it has almost given you seven reports. So obviously it has prepared seven reports or six major pieces of legislation. So if I talk about the major pieces, if I'll exclude this fourth one, then obviously there are six major pieces of legislation: Indian Succession Bill, Contract Bill, Negotiable Instruments Bill, Evidence Bill, Transfer of Property Act, Revised Criminal Procedure. All has been created by the Third Law Commission within a short span of only 9 years. So within 9 years, six major pieces of legislations were prepared by the Third Law Commission. This is a tremendous achievement, very big achievement. Obviously, you people understand what is a draft. Draft takes a lot of time for it to be prepared. What should be the laws? What should be the sections? What should be the subsections? Why this law? Why this section should be included? Everything needs to be debated. And within a period of only 9 years, they have created six major pieces of legislation, which is still followed today. So just imagine that what has been the work that has been done by the Third Law Commission. Therefore, it is known as, obviously, I told you, this is known as the golden age of codification, because a lot of codes, a lot of laws were actually passed during this time. But the commission unfortunately came to an end on an unhappy note in 1870 due to strained relations between commission and the government of India. So basically it worked for 9 years. It was like it would have worked for more years. But what has happened that the working of the commission came to an end in 1870 because the relations were strained between this Third Law Commission and the government of India. Obviously, I told you over here, it has questioned the government of India, objected the government of India that why this section has been included in the contract bill. And therefore, over here, you can see that there were major differences which were there between the government of India and the commission. And therefore, in 1870, the commission has to end. And after this, there was another last commission that came during the British era in India, and that was the Fourth Law Commission. Now, I'll start with the Fourth Law Commission. Though many important branches of law has been codified so far, still some remain uncodified. So majority of the laws, if you people know, has been codified, but there were still certain laws that were left to be codified. And thus in 1875, Lord Salisbury, the Secretary of State for India, so in 1875, Lord Salisbury was VSOS, Secretary of State for India, called the attention of the Government of India about the urgent need for the appointment of law commission. So there was a need for law commissions because there were certain laws which were still uncodified. And in 1877, the Government of India, while accepting the proposals of Lord Salisbury, entrusted Dr. Whiteley Strokes. So who was the chairman who was leading the fourth law commission? He was Dr. Whiteley Strokes, with the preparation of bills dealing with private trust. So these are the laws which are still yet to be formed, and therefore they were framed during the fourth law commission. So the preparation of the bills regarding the private trust, easement, alluvion, dilution, master and servant, negotiable instruments, and TPA, Transfer of Property Act. Thus, all these matters were given to Dr. Whiteley Strokes, that within your commission, that with the work of your commission, these bills should be enacted into proper acts. And thus, what has happened on 11 February 1879, these bills were referred to the Fourth Law Commission for consideration and report. So these bills were referred, that you suggest us how this should be made, how these should be drafted as proper laws. The commission submitted its report on 15th November 1879. In its only report, the Fourth Law Commission made the following recommendation. So there was one report, only one report that was submitted by the Fourth Law Commission. And I have written what were the recommendations that has been made by the Fourth Law Commission. First is, the process of codification of substantive laws should continue. He said that the process of continuing, that means to get the drafting of the substantive law for India should continue. That means whatever laws have yet not been codified, the procedure should start to codify them. Second, the English law should be made the basis for the future codes in India, and its material should be recast. That means whatever laws will be made in India, the basis can, the England law can be made as the basis for that. That means obviously when people do not have anything to refer, then obviously being India being governed by England only, Britishers only, then the England law can be used for referring it. And therefore, but all the material needs to be recast. Again, it should be revised. The law of actionable wrongs should be codified. There was another law known as law of actionable wrongs that needs to be codified. The uniformity in legislation should be aimed at, but local and special customs should be treated with great respect. The legislature should then deal with the law of property in its whole extent. That means it was said that it is important to have uniformity. I told you the reason why law commissions came in India was to bring uniformity in the legal system. Uniformity means all the laws will be same, will be with the same enforcement, that they'll be enforced in throughout the length and breadth of the country. That means law which will be applicable to Jammu and Kashmir will also be applicable to Madras. So this was the main agenda, and therefore it was said that there is important. Therefore, it was said that it is important to have uniformity in legislation. But the local and the special customs which are there among Indians, that needs to be specially treated with respect. So that means whatever the Indian customs and traditions are, that needs to be respected because they are local customs, traditional customs. And apart from that, there should be uniformity in legislation. Obviously, if you people understand why the civil laws are different for Hindus and Muslims, it is majorly because of their own special customs and traditions. So obviously, Hindu Marriage Act, Hindu Divorce Act is completely different from Muslim Divorce Act and Muslim Marriage Act. And therefore, it was said that uniformity in legislation is required. One single law which that will be applicable throughout the length and breadth of the country is required. But wherever there are traditions and local custom, that needs to be given respect. So these were the recommendations that were made by the Fourth Law Commission. First is that there should be this process to codify the law should continue. English law can be made as the basis while codifying laws for India. Law of actionable wrong should be codified, and there should be uniformity in legislation. But at the same time, the law commission should also respect the local traditions and customs of the people in India. Now we come to the achievements of the Fourth Law Commission. If I'll deal with the achievements which were catered by the Fourth Law Commission, then Does the Legislative Council of India, on the recommendation of the Law Commission, pass codes relating to negotiable instruments in 1881 and those relating to trust, transfer of property and easement in 1882? So if you people know, Negotiable Instrument Act, PPA Act, trust related acts or easements, they were passed in 1882 and 1881. And the law of civil wrong, that is known as torts. So torts, maybe you would have studied what are torts and how it is like, what are the laws in the torts. So the law of civil wrong, which is also known as torts, was not codified through Indian Civil Wrongs Bill, was prepared. Though Indian Civil Wrongs Bill was prepared, until today this area is uncodified and is mostly covered by English law of torts. So basically, till today also English law of torts are being used. There was the Indian Civil Wrongs Bill or Indian torts was not properly codified, and we continue to use the English law of torts. So basically this area remained uncodified. Thus, with the fourth law commission came to an end the phase of law commissions, and no more law commissions were appointed thereafter during the British period. See, people also know that after this, the fourth law commission, there was no more law commissions that came during the British era. So basically, law commissions still come today. They give a lot of reports, submit a lot of reports and recommendations. For example, Lokpal and EFS, etc. has been recommended by the law commissions only. So law commissions comes to India in the after the independence. But during the British era, there were only four law commissions that came. I told you about, I mentioned about all the four. I'll just give you a recap what has been covered in the third law commission. In the third law commission, all these reports were submitted. The Indian Succession Bill, Contract Bill, Negotiable Instrument Bill, Evidence, TPA, and revised draft of criminal procedure. These reports were submitted. If I talk about the achievement, then within a span of only 9 years, they have submitted 6 major draft of legislation, which is a commendable work. If I come to the fourth law commission, then it was under Dr. Whiteley Stokes, and it was given the task to prepare all these private trust, easement, allocation, dilution, master and servant, negotiable instruments, TPA, all these drafts needs to be prepared. And it submitted its report to the government, in which he said that there is a requirement to codify procedure to codify the laws should continue. And English law should be made as the basis for the future codes in India. There should be uniformity in legislation, but at the same time, the local traditions and customs of the people need to be respected. And lastly, if I come to the achievements of the fourth law commission, then all these important acts have been passed under it, except the law of torts is not there in India. We still continue to follow the English law of torts. So basically, after this, no more commissions came in India, and majority of the legislations that you study today, majority of the drafts that you read today were prepared during this time only. So as you people know, it was only the under the law commission only that the majority of the drafts and majority of the acts that you study today have been from. So basically, this is also known as a golden time for India, or a golden phase, especially the third phase. Why? Because majority of your laws were codified here. So you people should, obviously this can come as a good question to you people in your final exams. You people should prepare it well. I hope you have understood the lecture. In case of any problems, you can mail me. In case of any doubts, you can mail me. Or any other topic which you want me to cover, which you have not understood, obviously you can mail me the same. My mail ID is swati.saxena@alc.edu.in. Thank you so much.